Hi there, welcome to this channel once again. Over the past few days, I have observed many things from the various groups of WhatsApp and Instagram and Telegram in which I am a member for the students who are appearing for the second METS and the GMDSS exams. There were a few questions I had posted on the group yesterday, which are very, very important, but may not be in the syllabus of your second METS or GMDSS. Maybe the GMDSS examiners, they have not asked this type of questions. But unfortunately, what has happened is that around 90% of the candidates who are appearing for the exams are either not aware of any such regulations being in force, or they are trying to give wrong answers or trying to impress. And there have been some people who have gone to the extent of abusing, telling this is not in the syllabus. I do agree, this is not in the syllabus of your second METS functions or orals or even in your GMDSS exams. But as a sailing officer, maybe as a second officer or a chief officer, you should be aware that your vessel can encounter such a situation and the consequences can be very disastrous. So it is always better to be preventive and take precautions to avoid unnecessary happenings with the Coast Guard and the PSC wherever you go. Especially the topic we are going to discuss today is about the EPIRB. Two matters, two issues with respect to the EPIRB is going to be discussed today. One, the location of mounting of EPIRB, and number two, your EPIRB is replaced. What will you do under these two conditions? Now let us take the first case. Your EPIRB is mounted on the bridge wings, port or starboard, which is accepted by the SOLAS and the IMO regulations, and there is no issues. But on joining a vessel as a second officer or as a third officer who is in charge of your LSA, FFA, you find the EPIRB is fixed on the monkey island in one of the railings, either towards the aft or towards the forward or towards the port and starboard, but the location is in the monkey island. And the access to the monkey island is given via a vertical ladder. Unfortunately, within the first 15 days of your sailing or joining the vessel or the vessel calling the next port, you have your LSA FFA annual survey. Maybe, God bless you if this is going to happen in US waters or in AMSA waters, where the surveyors are very strict. And if the surveyor sees such an arrangement, I am 100% sure that he is going to detain your vessel under detention 17. Why? Because it is very clearly given in the ALRS volume 5 that access to any life-saving equipment, especially EPIRB if it is housed in the monkey island, should not be through a vertical ladder. A staircase has to be provided. Now let us see the logic behind this. What is the big logic behind this staircase? We all know when the vessel is going to be abandoned and if the EPIRB or a SAT has to be carried, it has to be done humanly, right? And let us assume a scenario where the EPIRB is in the monkey island, the person goes up to the monkey island, retrieves the EPIRB, carries it in one hand, and comes down the vertical ladder. Let us imagine, let us visualize this and see whether this is going to be possible. If I were a second officer or a third officer, or even a person who as a cadet, I would definitely not prefer to do this because I know it is not going to be possible. Holding an EPIRB in one hand, trying to climb down with the other hand in the vertical ladder is difficult, and it is definitely not possible by even any Spider-Mans in the world. So the usage of a critical equipment at lifetime at emergency is reduced. To avoid this, vertical ladder access to the EPIRB, if it is placed in the monkey island, is not accepted by the surveyor nor by the SOLAS. You can refer this in ALRS volume 5, handbook for GMDSS, where it is very clearly given. It is not acceptable, period. Vessel can be detained. One scenario of the EPIRB. Now let us come to the second scenario of a EPIRB. Let us say you have a particular model of EPIRB on board and your battery is expiring, 5-year battery is expiring. What should you do? And you are in a godforsaken port called Bata in West Africa. You don't get anything there. Even if you get anything, it will be costing you hell a lot, and your superintendent or the company will definitely not be in a mood to spend that much of money. They will just try to push up to the next port, maybe in Europe or the Mediterranean or some other place where you can get the items. But now, let us assume you are having an SEQ survey or an SRT survey and EPIRB has to be made operational. Somehow the company has managed to give you a new EPIRB, which is different from the one which you already have on board. What should be your action? What are the things you are going to check up? Even for this, most of the students, they were not aware of the answer. Now, the answer for this is, since this is a new EPIRB supplied by your company, the manufacturer or the OEM of the EPIRB would have already programmed the EPIRB with your MMSI, your IMO number, your call sign, your details, blah, 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 blah. So that part is taken care of. The manufacturer or the OEM is also going to give you an annual testing certificate as per the IMO format MSE 1040, which is valid for 1 year, and also the 5-year SBMC 1039, which is required by the IMO, where it has to be given only by the OEM representative of the particular product. Fine. Apart from this, the EPIRB comes on board and you are the third officer responsible for this. What are the things you are going to do? We also know that this EPIRB has to be registered with the registering authority. If it is in India, it is in INMRCC in Bangalore. But of course, this is going to be done by the owners and not by the vessel staff. So let us assume that the owners or the superintendents are active enough and they do this. Then it comes on board. As a third officer in charge for LSA and FFA, what are you going to do? Well, I was surprised to see people giving all wrong type of answers, which I didn't expect from sailing second officers or from third officers. And even I could identify some chief officers giving wrong answers. How I identified them as a chief officer is a different story. Now, as a surveyor, if I board such a vessel, I'm going to look for two things. Apart from the mandatory documents which is given by the equipment, registration, etc., 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 the one document which I am going to see whether your SBMC for your GMDSS is modified with the details of your new EPIRB. This is mandatory as per the class, as per the SOLAS. Even though you have your SBMC issued by the manufacturer of the EPIRB 1039, your shore-based maintenance for GMDSS equipment should also have the details of these EPIRB with serial numbers, expiry date of batteries, etc., 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 included, and this modification has to be done. If this is not done, according to me, I can very well put an observation. And depending on the other deficiencies, I can even hold the vessel. I can detain the vessel from sailing. Having said this, what is the other thing which you are going to see? The next thing is that we all know that we have a book, a dirty book probably in the size of an A4 ledger, placed in the engine room, placed in the crew mess, placed in the officer's mess, which we call as a familiarization book or the induction training book. What we do whenever a new person joins a ship. We simply try to tell him that this book is available there, your manual is available there, just take it over, read it over, sign it. And as a sailing officer, I have done it many times that even without taking one, turning one page of the manual, I have just signed it, assuming that I know everything, but it is wrong. In the case of EPIRB, there might be new staff, new crew, there might be old crew. The old crew must have been familiarizing with themselves with the activation and the operation of the old EPIRB during the drills. But they may not be knowing about the new EPIRB which has come on board. Similarly, the same thing holds good with the new staff joining the ship. So, the regulation very clearly says that within the first 36 hours of sailing of the vessel, a familiarization or an induction program has to be conducted for the benefit of the newcomers or the new joiners in the vessel. And this has to be logged. If this is not done, this is again a violation of the regulation, and depending upon the severity of other issues, the vessel might be held in a port affecting your sailing. If imagine what will be the condition if this is in places like US or in Japan or in Australia, where the regulations are very strict. So, when you join the vessel next time as a third officer, after getting your COCs, ensure that your first priority for life saving should be in concurrence with the points discussed, and also ensure that your familiarization checklist is completed, even for the old staff, for the new staff, and whoever it is. And as usual, watch this channel for more informative videos on JMDSs, on Morse codes, and other topics. You can also ask me questions, and wherever it is possible, I will try to answer. If I don't know the answer, I will find the answer and I will let you know the answer. But be sure that I will not give you a bullshit of an answer. Thank you very much for watching. Happy learning.